So we're now Biulainyanu. This is what chapter are we? Three, right?
It's the third chapter. It's very hard to work it out with this.
And let me see. One,
I think so.
Two, three, four. In chapter four.
Okay.
We said that Avraham was the first one to bring down the Chafetz Chesed, the Sechel HaNe'ela. How did he do it?
He complained to Kodesh Baruch Hu, since Avraham Avinu was created, I got nothing to do.
Okay. So that's how he brought it down. So he said that to bring it down, it's not enough for a person to sit and think. How am I going to tap into my higher mind, into my concealed mind?
That's the way you
go. You have to do something. But he says, this type of doing is called melacha. That's the main thing. But this type of doing is exactly the same type, it's analogous to what Hashem did when he created the world. So Hashem also wanted to reveal something. What did he want to reveal into the world? Name Avaya. So he took the six midos, and in the context of creation, they're called the 6 days of creation. And through them, he revealed himself.
Why not the seven midos?
Oh, why is there not? Why is it Malchus? Malchus is also something, but Malchus, in the context of creation, was to return because it's not finished. It was to return into his mind. It's like he reflected everything, he projected it, and on the seventh day, he stopped doing that and he went back into the source of his mind. So, in our context, it means that on the seventh day, we rest from fulfilling ourselves, from doing what we do during the rest of the week. But we don't do something with Malchus. Okay? The Malchus is not complete. It's like almost, it's almost saying that during the 6 days of the week, we're trying to build a kingdom. But on the seventh day, you don't build the kingdom, but rather you refrain from it, meaning saying that you go back into the plan, you go back into the source. So there's no seventh midah in the sense of that you do something with it. That's what it means, that the seventh midah, the malchus, is like some kind of receptacle. It's a kli to receive everything that you did. But it's not something you do with. Okay?
It's just the control and the deal with that
day.
Okay. So now, we got 6 meters. And all these Jewish people were all busy running around doing all sorts of interesting things. Okay? So when they go in, all the Moroccan, or Kodesh Baruch Hu, these Jews, refraining from eating non-kosher, or he's making his kitchen kosher, he's making his bedroom kosher, whatever it is. And that's making a deal with Tachton. That's Kiddush Hashem, if you will.
Okay?
When it comes to Shabbos, and a Jew doesn't do anything, that's the biggest Kiddush Hashem. That's the biggest bringing a Kodesh Baruch Hu into this world. So the boy would say, why are these Jews doing nothing? Because it's Shabbos, you're not working, no. I can't do business with it? No. So that's an even bigger bringing Hashem down into the world. So why do you say we're doing nothing?
Because we're not continuing to fulfill new parts of the plan. We're leaving it the way it was. That's kol melachto asuya. That's what he explained before. The kol melachto asuya is the feeling that I'm going back to the source. All my toil is finished. So I'm going back to the source. What's my toil? My toil is to bring down Hashem into the world. So I go back to the source and I enjoy az titanag al avaya. I'm above avaya even. I enjoy the very fact that there is Hashem. I don't continue to try to project Him into the world. I don't continue to bring it down into the world. Okay? Rather, I go to connect back to the source. It's like going back to fuel. Energized. But I'm not energizing in the sense of I'm adding energy to myself. I'm just going back to enjoy that we have a really good reason we're doing all this. And so what you're saying is that it's a bigger Kiddush Hashem, is that it reveals the reason behind all the actions on the 6 days. But it's not an action in and of itself. And that's how Malchus is different from the other 6 midos. The other 6, Malchus really isn't called a midah, usually. It's not something that you measure with. It's not something, it's not like, again, when you say measure, it's like a person working on a building and he's got measuring stick and he's got different vessels with which he creates his bricks or whatever it is. And each one of these is useful for a few different things. But Malchus is not a vessel in that sense. Leitle migal meklum, it's not even a vessel. It's the projection, it's where you project everything that you've done. So, for instance, a lot of times, Malchus is connected to time. Okay. You say, Hashem Melech, Hashem Malach, Hashem Mimloch. So from that we learn that Malchus is related to the time, the three tenses of time. So time is, you don't build time, okay, but you work within time. And it's some kind of, or a lot of times Malchus is space. Sorry?
You can get enslaved by time, never mind.
You're not enslaved by time ever. What you're enslaved is by your mind. And you just you project that enslavement on time. Okay. It's your mind, it's your feeling that you have to do so and so that enslaves you. But it's not the passage of time itself. You can sit at home and time passes and you didn't do anything and you don't have to feel, again, it depends on where you are in your mind space. Anyway, getting back to this, that now we said that for Avram to bring down this sechel ha'ne'elam mikol ha'rayon, this chafetz chesed, these abilities that were dormant, and we said, what does it mean? It means that nobody knew Hashem. Somebody asked me yesterday in another shir that I gave. Where did I give a shir yesterday? I gave a shir on psychology. So somebody asked whether the generations before Avraham had anxiety over the fact that they couldn't express Hashem in the world. I said, I think that yes, that the fact that Chanoch disappeared was, I think it's if I would write a, I'm sure there's a midrash like this, but if I would have to write one, I would say that it was out of mitzukah. Is it mitzukah?
Out of fear of doing wrong.
Hashem took him before, but what was his feeling? Ve'inenu. It says ve'inenu. Is it, even the whole verse is equal to 11 times ve'inenu. Ve'itelech hanoch et ha'elokim. I can remember, there's 11 words in this pasuk, and it's equal to 11 times the last word, ve'inenu. So, what do you mean? He nullified it. Why did he nullify? Why did he, like, the Medrash says that he kept going up a mountain to be separate from the world. So in a certain sense, he was trying to bring Hashem down. On the other hand, he gave up. It was just too impossible. He couldn't figure out. He didn't know what the secret was. Until Avram came along. And when Avram came along, the secret became revealed, that you have to use the midos with which Hashem created the world. So what did Avram use? He used chesed. And then Yitzchak used gvura. But each one of them did act that brought Hashem down into it. That's what he's saying here. Okay. So now he's going into the siskalalus. He said that the main thing about these midos, it's not that nobody ever did chesed before Avram, but it wasn't Rach kakane. It wasn't the midot of Hashem. It was like for a gain, for some kind of purpose. Or if you're not loving kindness, that's harsh. Is that if everybody else is not full of loving kindness, then I hate them. And Avram was the first person to have sevlanut also. At the same time that he had a lot of chesed, he also had gvura, that he also forced people to say a bracha. He also had tiferet. I guess he had some way of making it feel like compassion, and not just as a handout, something else, and so on. So now he's going to explain this itkalelut. Ve'ura inyanu, what does itkalelut mean? What does inter-inclusion mean? Dinei adua she'ava nikret chesed. Love is called chesed in Kabbalah. Kama shekatu, ve'avat olam ha'avtich, al ken meshachtich chesed. I've loved you permanent, eternal love. Therefore, I have drawn you with chesed, loving kindness. V'chesed shebachesed. So now, if each midah is inter-included with all the others, then we have to explain what it means to have chesed in chesed, gvura in chesed, tiferet in chesed, and so on. So chesed shebachesed. היינו, אהבה נגלית מתוך אהבה מסותרת שבטבע נפש האדם. So chesed shebachesed, he says, the first chesed is the minor one. It's chesed shebachesed. The second chesed is the major one. So the second, you don't see it. So it's called ahava mesuteret. It's like saying that I have ahava mesuteret. It's like I have a natural love. That's what it is in the Tanya. That every person, every Jew has a natural love for Hashem. So chesed shebachesed, he says here, it's to reveal the natural love. It's the love that comes out of the natural love. וחסד שבחסד, היינו אהבה נגלה מתוך אהבה המסודרת שבדבר נפש שלנו. כמו אהבת האב לבנו, כשהיא מתגלית לעיני כל, דאגם שאין בה התחדשות, כי אהבתו טבעית היא ובתמידיות. ובזה הרי אין הפרש כלל בזמן, להתקשרות האב והבן היא תמידית. לכן כיבוד אב תמידי, ומכבדו בחייו בעל מדינו, וחייו הנצחיים. וכל זהו לפי שההתקשרות היא תמידית. This is what does natural love of a father for a son mean? It means that it's always there, even if it's not being revealed at this moment. So that's a ahava mesuteret between a father and son. What would chesed sheva chesed be? That at times he shows his affection, he shows his love. So that's chesed sheva chesed. And why is this possible? It's all because this love that he has, the natural love, is constant. It doesn't really ever leave him, but it's not always expressed. And therefore, it also goes in the other direction, that the son is always required to honor his father, even if his father is not showing him his love at that moment. And not only is it constant in the sense of in this world, it's also constant in the world to come. The world of the neshamos. In the neshamos, there's also an element of love of the father for the son. It's just that he can't remember it. And all the stories about people who went to Gan Eden and saw their parents, they didn't remember who they were. there's a story from the Baal Shem Tov like that, also. There's stories like that. So they all ask, well, how can, what do you mean, the connection between us is not eternal? Yes, it is eternal, but when you're not in this world, it's hard to express it. You don't find it. You don't remember. And it's also the same. It's also true if a parent doesn't see his child for many years and he's already an adult. It's not that it's gone. It just takes a lot of work now to bring it out. So all the more so when a person has no physical stimuli. He only has his spiritual stimuli, which is the Torah. If he can't darshan his son into the Torah, then he won't remember. It's like any muscle that you don't use a long time. So he doesn't remember even that he has a son to that point. So it's called la'irat ahava, la'irat ahava aishana, that there's old love and it has to be brought back to the foreground. In any case, when you bring it out, when you're able to express it and see signs that this love exists, that's called chesed shebechesed. That's the hiskaludus, that's the inter-inclusion of loving kindness in loving kindness, or love in love. והיינו שמעצמות המידה, המידת החסד והאהבה, על שמלובשת המידת האהבה בדבר שהוא היפוכו, חסד שבחסד להתגלות אהבה והקרוב לו, וברא שבחסד להתגלות אהבה, דבר שהוא היפוכו, כמו לשנוא את מי ששונא לבנו או לא אהבו. So he says, it's to hate the one that I love. That's the גבורה of חסד. So it's חסד, it comes from the fact that I love my son. But the fact that I hate here is a big word, but that's what he uses. The fact that I hate somebody who hates him, it's because I love my son. So that's gvura shebechesed. That's the inter-inclusion of gvura into chesed.
Why are we only talking about chesed?
Because we're talking about Avram.
And gvura and chesed. Why don't we ever talk about the other three
things? We will. In a second, we will. That's a chodesh. We have to. If he doesn't say it, it's just because he didn't. He expects you to figure out yourself. Okay. The more he loves his son, the more he hates those who oppose him, his son. What is Tiferet Shebach Hesed? Tiferet, usually they explain this from the word the Yofi. Pe'er and Yofi, they're very related. So it's to show beauty in the love, meaning that he shows his love, he expresses it in a beautiful way, in some kind of it could be that if it's a husband for his wife, that it's with something that's beautiful. ונצח שבחסד הוא ההשתדלות להתקרב אל דבר הטוב וגם אם יהיו מניעות רבות מאוד לנצח את עצמו לעמוד נגד כל מונע מעכב והגיע לטוב ולהתגברות כוח הניצחון. The נצח of chesed is that if a person really loves something and the love for it is ingrained in him, then he will vanquish, he will conquer and surmount any obstacles that he has on the way to being close to this thing. So that's Netzach Sheva Chesed. What is Hod Sheva Chesed? Ulilchom be'ad bno ve'avo ulatzilo me'oivav. Hod is more than just Gvura. Because Gvura is just to hate, it's just to feel. But Hod and Netzach are actions already. So here he actually fights. He writes an article against the guy who's bad-mouthing his son and writing terrible articles about him, whatever. Yesod shebechesed hu itkashrut ha'ohev b'ne'ahav. Yesod is always itkashrut. It's always a connection. Like yesodot, zivug neshikin. The two people are close enough to actually touch each other. It's like the connection, a connection that could be speaking one to another, but it's usually like hugging or something like that. U'malchut shebechesed hu dibur ha'ohev im ha'ne'ahav. And dibur and malchus of chesed would be to speak to one another, because malchus many times is speech. Just you know, from bidvar melech shilton, that the power of malchus is speech. Okay. V'nei pirtei midot elu ishnam gam ba'avodat Hashem. Just as these exist between people, they also exist in relation to Hashem. Serving Hashem, the negative. Ve'avta et Hashem lokecha b'chol levavcha b'chol nafshecha. Obviously, we have a mitzvah to love Hashem. Ve'avta et Hashem lokecha. You should love Hashem, your God. Ve'ayinu da'agam de'kol echad b'echad mi'Yisrael yesh lo ahava atzmit la'Hashem. Even though each of us has an essential love to Hashem. מכל מקום אין זה מספיק עדיין, it's not enough. לפי שהאהבה הזו היא אהבה מסותרת, שהיא בעלם הנפש בכל אחד ואחד מישראל. Why? Because, like the Tanya says, the natural love for Hashem is concealed in the heart. That a person, even though it'll never move, he'll have it his whole life, he can't express it naturally. He has to do work in order to express this love. So the work will now become exactly like we said in terms of the relationship between a father and a son. How? That umkom koen zeh maspik adayin. Lefi she'ahava zo ahava mesoteret shehi be'alem hanefesh kol echad ve'echad miYisrael. Ve'al zeh omer ve'ahavta, you should love she'tehe b'gilui b'nefesho. It has to be expressed, it has to be revealed, this love. Ve'ayinu she'tehe b'itgalut alev. And itgalut alev means an experience. It should be an experience of love. D'amitat ha'avodah d'ahava v'yirah hu she'yeh b'itgalut dafka. V'zehu chesed shebechesed she'avadu b'chol nafshecha she'yoter mibchinat ha'avadu b'chol levavcha. And that's why chesed shebechesed is what we call with all of your soul, which is more than with all of your heart. And the order is b'chol levavcha u'b'chol nafshecha u'b'chol mo'odecha. So b'chol levavcha is that you have a natural love in your heart. But it doesn't necessarily become revealed. It's not necessarily expressed. A lot of people walk around with a feeling that their lives are empty. When is life empty? Because they have nothing to love. But it's not true. You have. What?
They love themselves.
No, that's not love. That's the most. If a person really loved himself, he would never copy anybody else. When you want to really give yourself a gift, what do you do? said it. Why? Because only you can do that. Nobody else can sleep for you. Okay? People eat. Okay? But unfortunately, a lot of people, they go and they watch something, and then they say, oh, I wish I had this, I wish I had that. Okay? Don't worry about it. I wish I had this, I wish I had that. They're not thinking really about themselves. They don't really care about themselves. If they cared about themselves, they would ask, what do I really want? Not what is somebody else telling me I want. What do I really want? So to reveal my love for Hashem is really like asking, what do I really want? Because that's the driving force behind everything, that I have this hidden, concealed love for Hashem. And Hashem is all the goodness in the world. So when I say, what do I love? What am I attached to? What am I connected to? What moves me? That's really beginning to reveal my love for Hashem. Okay? But if a person like sits at home and he doesn't know that this whole, he knows, he has bookshelves full of books. And he doesn't take one down. He doesn't say, what do I want to learn now? He doesn't ask that question. So that's like the love remaining concealed. It's there. There's a life force there. But he doesn't use it. Instead,
he has the books
there. Okay. That's like the concealed love.
Okay.
Exactly. It's like he has concealed love in his. But until you open the book and you actually start learning, and you say, this is important to me, or you go do a mitzvah, you're not expressing your innate love for Hashem. And again, you have to replace Hashem always with something that works in the sentence. Because just to say, I love God, doesn't mean anything. Because nobody knows what God is. So you have to replace it with something that works. So the easiest thing is, I love goodness. So which goodness do you love? Do you love helping people? Do you love cooking for people? Do you love, I don't know, writing something that will help other people? What do you love? When you say you love, transform that love of what you do and understand that it can be a service of Hashem. So that's what it means, chesed shebechesed. That you don't leave it, I just love in general. No. I love something specific. To love with all your heart is to remain essentially unexpressed, dormant. אבל בכל נפשך, what does nefesh mean? Nefesh means anima, that you're animated, you're doing something. ושאהבה מתפשטת בכל מקום, גם בכוחות החיצוניים שאינם שייכים לאהבה. That this love becomes the driving force behind all my powers of my soul. Even those that are not like love. For instance, we said even hate. The fact that I refrain from engaging with something that's forbidden, that's also love of Hashem, but that's gvur shebechesed. Because I love Hashem, I love goodness, I will refrain from anything that causes the opposite. And so on. דיקר אהבה היא בלב שהלב אוהב, ומכל מקום מתפשטת אהבה גם שערי כוחות, אפילו כוחות חיצוניים. כמו אמת המים, what's the marshal for this? That there is a conduit of water. עוברת ממקום למקום שהולכת בלט. It goes quietly from place to place. ומוגבלת בגדותיים המקבילים אותה לפי שהמים הם במיעוט. And it's limited to traveling inside the conduit. אבל לפעמים, כאשר המים מתרבים ומתפשטים הגלותיהם, גם במקום שתמיד אין שם מילוך המים, כי אם בעת ריבוי המים, אז מתפשטים ביותר. Sometimes there's so much water, it overflows, so even the conduit, the water comes out of the vessels. So that's what it means, בכל נפשך, with all of the powers of your soul. That there's so that you let the love flow out in such a way that it fills all the other powers of the soul. It's the difference between love with the heart alone, and the love is not overflowing in a sense that it'll fill all the other powers of the soul. When you say "b'chol nefshecha," with all of your soul, we itpashtut ha'avah gam b'sharei ha'kochot ha'nefesh, gam b'kochot chitzonim, kmo she'yarutz lidvar mitzvah. So for instance, it becomes that the person runs to do a mitzvah. She'avah mitpashtet gam b'koach ha'iluch she'beregel, that even his power of walking, which is in the feet, is now filled with love. This is all what we call chesed of chesed in terms of love of Hashem. Obviously, the gvura of chesed is to hate everything that's against Hashem. Like David says in Tehillim Kuflamet Tet, hate everything that's against Hashem. Meaning that he hates very much the people who invent false religions, whose real purpose in the end is to serve themselves. And he hates them to the very end. He can't tolerate them at all. That's from the place of his love. וכל שאהבה להשם היא בתוקף ביותר, הנה יותר תהיה שנאתו למנגדי השם. It's very interesting that the Friedrich Rebbe, who was such a warm and inviting person, spends so many words, so many sentences, on how much he has to hate the negative things that people do against Hashem.
He never expressed it.
Right.
A child doesn't recognize his parents, so the parents don't recognize the child, and the child comes to Gan Eden.
Now, all the stories are usually that the person who went up was alive. And the person...
They're connected with the Alzheimer's, they're all the aging parents, but they no longer recognize the Shi'ura, and maybe Be'etz, and they do recognize them, but there's something broken down. I don't believe the people who are outside and people who sit with us all day long don't know what's going on. I'm sure they know exactly what's going on. But it's also the locked up somehow.
So the problem always with these diseases is that the brain is not working right. The soul continues to work fine. When you go to Gan Eden, though, there's no brain anymore. So you're only talking about what the soul...
A brain in Gan Eden?
How could you have a brain in Gan Eden? Brain's a physical creation.
Well, where's the thought coming from?
You said the brain is a thinking vessel. Nobody's ever seen thinking in the brain. We see memories, we see other things, we've never seen thinking. The brain is like an antenna for something else that's happening. What's the brain? What do we say? We say the neshama is enclosed in the brain. So the brain is the vessel that can contain the type of spirituality called the neshama, the thinking part of the neshama. In the same way that the eye doesn't see.
Yeah, it picks up the vision and brings it back to the brain.
So what would you call it? It's called an antenna. That's what you call it. Certainly in our way of thinking, where for us the body is passive. We don't see it the way they saw it. They saw the body as being active.
The whole story of the Maggid. When they asked the Maggid, how come Moshe really got angry? And so the feeling of the body itself has some power. So Moshe really got angry.
Of course it does. That's why you leave it at some point. Because you don't want to... Because the soul itself wouldn't get angry. And the body has its shortcomings.
You're talking about the soul just getting angry. Hating the
people that hate the soul. It's not unwarranted. In the case of Moshe Rabbeinu, it was improper. You shouldn't have gotten angry. And here, because they weren't people who hated Hashem, they were just thirsty, or whatever you want to say. And here he's talking about things that are warranted. So he says, in the soul there is such a power to deflect, to push away whatever is against Hashem.
So, what's going to happen?
You're going down here?
It's going to happen. Yeah, I'm going to finish. Okay. Come to me sometimes.